watching a master at work.
Yo, today is very important for me, you heard? For a few reasons. Not only is this my first vlog on Neztalgic, but I'm on my way to see the legendary pioneer Ralph McDaniels of Video Music Box. A lot of people know who he is. I mean, he broke a lot of your favorite rappers, but some people don't, especially these young shorties. So I figured I'd educate him real quick, you know what I mean? Let him know what's going on. So we on our way to see Uncle Ralph right now at an undisclosed location. We're gonna talk about a lot of shit. You know what I'm saying? Real hip hop shit. And this is the beginning of the Neztalgic series. You know what I mean? Everything is nostalgic. Vintage, fly, classic, legendary. So we about to honor the greats. Yeah, we live here with Uncle Ralph, you know?
Yeah.
Neztalgic, Lil Nez, you know, I'm saluting and preserving the culture, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, indeed.
Creative control, we in the building, you know what I'm saying? We about to honor the big homie right here. We in the archive spot.
We got the big tapes. This is what we got here. I don't even know right now, you know, it's probably gonna be all kinds of music. Look at that, Miami boys, gangsta bass. It just sounds crazy.
Yeah, man, so we gonna get in depth, man, get into a little history, you know what I mean? We about to honor the homie. He gonna tell us, you know what I mean, what he's done and how much of a pioneer he is, you know what I'm saying? And all y'all young homies out there, man, y'all need to pay homage and respect, you know what I'm saying, what it's due, because y'all want to be part of hip-hop, but y'all talk that hip-hop, but y'all don't honor, and it's five elements, you know what I'm saying? It's knowledge,
yes, sir.
MCing, DJing, breaking, and graffiti, you know what I'm saying? So this brother represented and documented all of that since day one, and I grew up watching it, and I'm a product of it. So he's everybody's uncle, so y'all gotta salute. So we about to take y'all with this shit, man.
Alright.
Sure.
This is dope, man.
So yeah, we down here in the vaults, man, with Uncle Ralph. This is very historic to me personally, and just I want y'all to see how long this has been going on, man. Like, this is years, bro. Like, years and years and years of your favorite videos, you know what I mean? Historic videos, classic videos, and just you know what I mean? Music in general, man. And this brother right here is responsible, so we're gonna get into a lot of things so y'all could get aware and just find out why we here and what we doing, you know what I mean?
Yes, indeed.
What, first of all, what made you have a love for video and like videography, just to get into it before the...
Yeah. I mean? Well, I went to school for TV and film.
Mm-hmm.
You know, before that, I was, you know, out, you know, going to school, high school, whatever, dope. DJing, you know, plugging in the park back in the days. And the music part was already there, the DJing thing, you know, the DJ culture. And so... when I went to school, I went to New York Tech in Westbury, Long Island, and they had the film and TV course, so I took that. I was a communications major, and that's how I started getting into the whole video world. I wanted to combine the music and the visuals.
Right, because I know you got a genuine love for music just off top. I could just tell,
yeah,
like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that was, and everything I did after, you know, is all about, you know, kind of moving it like a DJ would, you know. Taking them on a journey with the music, you know, keeping it on beat for certain songs, you know, we was mixing videos in the 80s before they even had the technology, you know, to do that. So, you know, now we, you know, I'm a real VJ. I go to clubs and, you know, mix videos
mix it up
and stuff
and kill
like
it.
That.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
So that evolved. And then, like, how'd you, I know personally, but I just want the people to know what was the opportunity, you know, for you to get on TV, you know, in a public, what was it? How can I say? Is it public access TV or?
It was public. It's public TV. It's not really public access. It's too. Mm-hmm. It's kind of different, but okay. You know, it's similar.
Right.
So, when I graduated from school, they gave me a job. I worked at this station, WNYC. It's now called NYC TV, and it was
original Channel 31, right?
Original Channel 31. Right. Yeah. I got the original T-shirt that we made for Video Music Box and everything. It says Channel 31 on the back. And that's how it started. You know, they gave me an opportunity. I came up with an idea because I saw a couple of videos or performances of artists. They weren't really even videos. Mm-hmm. Videos wasn't really even out like that. But, you know, then Michael Jackson, right, and Prince, and, you know, the Gap Band, and kind of R&B groups like that back in the days, the Whispers, they started coming out with videos. This is before hip-hop was even making videos.
So and this had to be like 70s, early...
Late 70s, early 80s, yeah.
Like 81, 80,
yeah, 80, exactly. 80. So by the time we actually got the show on the air now, there's, you know, What People Do for Money, Divine Sound.
I remember that. I posted it on my blog.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, man. Stuff like that.
Yeah.
Problems of the world today.
Problems of the world today, yeah.
I got you. First, there's no such thing as coincidence. I don't believe in that.
True.
I believe in destiny. And I just feel like maybe, or not maybe, it was destined for you to be where you were at that moment.
Yeah.
To do what you're doing.
Yeah, no, it was all timing.
It was natural.
Yeah, it was like you say, it was destiny because, you know, it wasn't something that existed,
mm-hmm,
you know, prior to that. But I had the elements all ready.
Already,
I just didn't,
yeah,
know what to do with it until that time came.
That's crazy. Yeah. So from there, like, did you know any people that was artists, like DJs and rappers, or you met them along the field? You already knew some already.
Well, I knew Russell Simmons.
Cause you from the, you
right? I was at that time. I'm living in Queens Village.
Okay. And I was gonna ask you where you originally from.
212 in Murdoch.
Wow.
Yeah.
Shadyville.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah. So I'm over there, and you know Russell's on, you know, on Hollis.
That's 25th.
Exactly. And I used to see Russell in the park. I played ball. And I see Russell in the park. Russell was running around.
Quick question. Was he with his OG, Spuddy, his man, Spuddy?
Yeah, Spuddy.
Shout out to Spuddy, man.
Yeah, Spuddy, Puppet. Wow. That was his girl at the time.
Wow. Because yeah, I used to come up, you know, Uncle Russell put me on. Shout out to Russell.
Yeah.
He put me on. So
yeah.
You know, I know a little history of the old school. Yeah.
Exactly. So that's what was going on. And Russell was giving parties, Rush Promotions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was like, you know, Rush Promotions giving a party at, mm-hmm, you know, this place, that place. And he would come, and then he got a job working at a record company as like a promotion guy. He would bring the vinyl to people.
Hmm.
So he used to bring vinyl to me, you know, like every week, you know, like, yo.
But it's been like, yo, Ralph.
Exactly.
Bring this.
Play this. You know how he talks, right?
Oh, man.
You know, but it was like R&B records. Yeah. And then eventually he, you know, got his own stuff in like Curtis Blow.
Mm-hmm.
That was his first group he managed.
Right.
The first artist he managed. And so we started, you know, hanging out with them.
The breaks,
Christmas rapping.
All that.
Yeah, all of that. And Christmas rapping was dope, you know, because it was a record that got played on the radio because it was like a holidays, and I think
mm-hmm,
WBLS Frankie Crocker played it. And then we were in the in the Paradise Garage one night, cause we used to go to the garage because they played, you know, it was the hot spot.
Yo, these are legendary spots. Like, y'all, yo, like, shout out to all the original New Yorkers. Like, there's a lot of New Yorkers that's here,
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? But they don't know, like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? He's talking about that real essence, yeah, New York. My bad. I just got hyped.
They didn't play hip hop in there at all because Larry Levan didn't like hip hop, you know? And in fact, Russell gave him the record, and then dude threw the record and broke. Larry Levan, it was like, damn, he hates hip hop that much. And then it started playing on the radio that week. It was the holidays, right between Christmas and New Year's, and he couldn't help but play it. And then he threw it on like Christmas Eve in the garage, which didn't play no hip hop. You know, it was like a dance music, house music. Whatever the case was, you know, from there, you know, I started, you know, hanging with Russ. Mm-hmm. Used to meeting artists and things like that.
Because he was at
everything.
Like.
Yeah, and he was going uptown. He'd be going to the Fever and places like that. I never even went to the Fever.
He told me about Eddie Cheever in Hollywood. So mm-hmm, he was around when he was uptown.
Yeah, exactly.
With those guys.
Eddie Cheever, Hollywood, a bunch of other cats, but, you know.
Starsky.
Yeah, Eddie Cheever. I used to go to LaGuardia Community College. And Eddie Cheever used to come. We used to have a lot of parties there.
Wow.
Eddie Cheever would come there. And then I started going over to the Bridge, and I started meeting cats from the Bridge over there.
QB.
So, yeah. So, you know, the music started. It was a small circle, you know.
It wasn't like how big it is now. Right.
So, you know, there was only, you know, certain people that was into hip-hop, you know.
So, it's like if you was in it, everybody knew each other. Sort of like the jazz community, because my mom's a jazz musician.
Yeah, exactly.
So she came to New York from Utica. She moved to Brooklyn. So, like, all the Brooklyn musicians knew each other, you know what I'm saying? So, she was part of that.
Absolutely. It's very much, you know, parallel to jazz. You know, I've talked to jazz musicians who say, you know, that's how they feel about hip hop. You know, like,
right.
like it's very parallel. You know, it's considered, like, jazz was considered nigga music. Mm. That's the way they was breaking it down. Dizzy Gillespie told me that.
Mm.
He said when they first came out, he said, I asked him, what do you feel about hip hop? And he was like, well, it kind of reminds me of jazz. And he was like, it's like nigga music.
Mm.
And that's the way the general public looked at jazz, because it was, you know, done in small places, mm-hmm. you know, and things like that nature, which was the same way hip-hop
right,
came
we
out.
Dug it, we understood it, but to the masses,
right. like,
that's that nigga music.
Right.
Yo, this brother said he spoke to Dizzy Gillespie, y'all.
Like, and then we mm-hmm. started getting, you know, learning, you know, who the artist was, who was moving things, management. Most of the introductions came through Rush, you know,
yeah.
just hanging around him, and, you know, and eventually, you know, he got the Rush management, and everything started taking off from there. And then Run, and you know, and everything was moving.
That's crazy. So I understand, from what I've seen, you was the only person with a camera at the first national hip hop biggest tour, the Fresh Fest.
Fresh Fest, yeah.
How did that come about? How was that for you? And did you know that 30 years, 40 years later, that we'd be having big tours that we have now from that one?
Yeah, I mean, once you saw it, you knew yeah. this was going to be something that right. was going to be big, and it was going to be happening for every year. Like, there's no, why wouldn't they do this every year?
Facts.
But the thing is that it was an opportunity to see, like, you know, like I said, hip-hop is a small community. Now you see 15,000 hip-hop heads, and they're not just black people, they're white people, they're
right,
Asian
it's
people.
A whole community.
It's just a community of hip-hop people.
Colors and...
So I think even cats from, you know, from Brooklyn, from the Bronx, you know, from Queens, you know, from the hood,
mm-hmm.
were like, I didn't know that white people was into music like that.
Right.
I didn't know the Asian kids
right,
was into
right.
music
they
like
really
that.
This.
Yeah. I didn't know that Puerto Ricans was into it like mm-hmm. that. Well, they probably knew that Puerto Ricans, because Puerto Ricans is always down and dancing and
right,
doing this
right,
and that.
Right, right.
But other than that, you didn't know, because if you didn't journey outside the hood. So
it
then you saw that.
Us.
Yeah, you saw that. It wasn't a cultural thing. It wasn't a color thing. It was a cultural thing. And it was all about you, whoever was into the music. We didn't care where you came from. You came from Mars.
That's what intrigued me. Like, I seen the footage, you know what I mean, of the Fresh and to see brothers like Larry Smith
mm-hmm.
and to see Grandmaster Flash and Melly Mel and then Run and Fat Boy, everybody's backstage. Interacting with each other before they go and greeting each other and cheering like
love.
That's crazy, like, you know what I mean, and to see where everybody evolved from, you know
yeah.
I'm sure you knew, but I'm sure just to see where Russell was at now and Joey and that,
yeah.
everybody, it's an incredible thing, man.
Yeah, you didn't know, you know, you just was watching it, and it was all kind of happening right in front of you, and it was like, okay, find your lane,
right,
you know. And so my thing was the video thing, you know, and that's why we created Video Music Box. And my partner, Lionel Martin, who directed a lot of videos with mm-hmm. our company, he was the vid kid on
vid
the show.
Kid. Yeah, I was about to say vid kid. It's funny that you going into that, because, you know, I wanted to get to some other things, but I also wanted to, you know, ask you how about, now on top of you having Video Music Box playing videos, you also had a company that shot videos and still does. Could
yeah.
you elaborate on that? And for some of y'all don't know, this brother is responsible for breaking some legendary MCs and doing their videos, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, for the people that don't know, you know,
yeah.
let them know what you did.
Well, I mean, we've done over 400 music videos, you know, through our company. And, I mean, some of the highlights, of course, were, you know, Nas.
It ain't hard to tell.
You know, it ain't hard to tell. You know, Nas, you know, was a fan of the show. He watched it. He's like, yo, I need to get up with you, Ralph. You know, how can we make this happen?
Did you do that documentary?
Yeah, we did the original.
Illmatic.
It wasn't even a documentary. It was an EPK. Yeah.
Mm.
And with EPK, it means just electronic press kit for, you know, for the artist to, they could send it out to the press and people could learn about Nas, because nobody knew who he was.
I'm in the studio with P-Rock.
Yeah.
Lodge. Primo, all of them, you mm-hmm. like, and had him in this, like, that was crazy. And going through QB,
yeah,
it's showing that, you know what I mean. Like, that was, I think, I haven't seen no one do that prior to since you,
yeah, nah,
on an artist. You know
I think
mean?
That it was a combination of what I was already doing and Nas being smart enough to say, I want to do exactly what you do on Video Music Box.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the record company didn't have a clue, you know, I mean, they did, but it hadn't developed yet
right,
into
right.
what they thought it would be. This is the beginning of Nas. So people are like, okay, it's a buzz, but is this really going to jump off?
Right. Do you feel that, I wouldn't say, you know what I'm saying, responsible? Everybody, I feel everyone has help. You don't get it on your own.
Mm-hmm.
But do you feel, but do you feel that you have a big hand as far as breaking brothers like Nas and Wu-Tang into New York hip-hop and just to the scene with their visuals and things like that? Because for me, my experience after I seen them on your station and heard it, it brought it to a whole, like, you know what I mean, a whole different awareness. Because, you know, after school, you know, we in school, we go to school, we come home and watch it, and then we go to school the next day, like, yo, son, you seen that video? You seen this group called Wu-Tang? And then, you know what it was, then we hear it on the radio, and it goes back to you, because we were the first people that see it. So, I don't know, do you know how important, or...
Yeah, I do, you know, I sometimes forget.
Nah, because you do so much, it's like you're in the moment, you live, but you know what I'm saying? Yeah, like, I want the viewers to know, like, how much of a hand you had in breaking, because, you know, we had DJs breaking rap artists, you know, we had the streets, and now we have the mixtapes and things like that, but you also created a platform of breaking artists just through a video, you know what I mean? And
I think a lot of people don't realize now that how we, you know, can go on YouTube and go on these, all these different places and see the visuals and watch MTV and BET and whatever it is, Revolt, whatever is out there right now, it wasn't like that.
Yeah, back you didn't then. Have all that.
You didn't have all of that. So there was only a few lanes that you could catch what you wanted, you know. And what Video Music Box did is every day, it was guaranteed we were going to have that.
Yeah.
And so that's what made it work for us, you know. So if it was Wu-Tang, if it was, you know, Nas.
Coach Chillin.
Cool. Yeah, the whole Coach Chillin, Big Daddy Kane, Biz, G-Rap. You know, Black Moon, we did their first video. You know, the list goes on. You know, working with some West Coast artists, you know, they just knew that, okay, we got to get with this cat because he understands where we're coming from. And so, you know, and I just was true to the audience. You know, I wasn't trying to, you know, create anything, a masterpiece. I just was like, we got to keep it regular and what it looks like to the hood. And that's why a lot of...
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. You know, a lot of the videos that I enjoyed the most were just real locations.
I see. There's another thing. Me personally, I can't speak for everybody. I like the videos that you showed that had the outside, like not green screen and you know what I mean. I like the real settings because it captured to me when I seen like Tribe Called Quest, Electric Relaxation, black and white, and them in the cab. It was just so authentic when Protect Your Neck when they was on Staten Island by the pier and just Nas outside in the snow.
Yeah.
It was real. Yeah, One Love, you know what I mean? Like all those videos, you know what I mean? It's all outside.
Well, what's funny now is like I was watching and you talk about keeping it in the moment. Like I was, we play on the show now on ASAP Mob, Traumatic.
Oh yeah, that's the man, the funky.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's like, it. You know, it's so, you know.
It brought back. How'd you feel back when you seen that? Like, you was like, wow.
Yeah, I mean, soon I heard the track, I was like, this is crazy. Mm-hmm. I can wait for to see the video.
Right, right.
And so they did a good job with the video. They kind of took the same kind of shots that were from that era.
So simple.
Dude. Yeah.
They was running in high.
Exactly. When I saw them running, I was like, oh, they got running in the video. That's what's up.
That's a homage.